αρχίζει η συνεδρίαση. Αξιότιμες και αξιότιμοι συνάδελφοι ακαδημαϊκοί, εκλεκτοί προσκεκλημένοι. Η Ακαδημία Αθηνών υποδέχεται σήμερα με ιδιαίτερη τιμή και ευχαρίστηση τον κύριο Αλμπέρτο Καρπιντέρι, καθηγητή δομικής μηχανικής στο Πολυτεχνείο του Τωρίνο της Ιταλίας, ως αντεπιστέλλον μέλος της Ακαδημίας, στον κλάδο της τεχνικής μηχανικής στην πρώτη τάξη των θετικών επιστημών. Ο κύριος Καρπιντέρι είναι διακεκριμένος επιστήμον στο διεθνές στερέωμα της δομικής μηχανικής και του σκυροδέματος. Έχει παρουσιάσει αξιόλογο διδακτικό και συγγραφικό έργο, έχει τύχει μεγάλης αναγνώρισης από τη διεθνή κοινότητα και έχει λάβει πολλαπλές διακρίσεις. Θα παρακαλέσω τον ακαδημαϊκό κύριο Εμμανουήλ Γδούτο να πάρει το λόγο, να προσέλθει στο βήμα και να προσιάσει το έργο του νέου συναδέλφου. Αλλά πριν από αυτό, επιτρέψτε μου να πω δύο λόγια σε μια γλώσσα κατανοητή για τον τιμόμενο. Dear Professor Carpentieri, I have expressed our great pleasure to have you here, to have the possibility and the honor to welcome you as a corresponding member of our academy. I have invited also our colleague Professor Gdoutos to present your research work and your personality. After that, I'll invite you to proceed and to be awarded the diploma of corresponding member here. And upon this, you'll have also the possibility to address the audience and to present your induction speech. Thank you. Κύριε Γδούτο, έχετε το λόγο.
Αξιότιμη κύριε Πρόεδρε της Ακαδημίας, αξιότιμη κύριε Γενική Γραμματεύ, αξιότιμη κύριε συνάδελφοι, κυρίες και κύριοι. Έχω την ιδιαίτερα τιμή και ευχαρίστηση να παρουσιάσω το νέο αντιπιστέλλον μέλος της Ακαδημίας Αθηνών, τον καθηγητή δομικής μηχανικής του Πανεπιστημίου Τωρίνου της Ιταλίας, Αλμπέρτο Καρπιντέρι, κατά την απόψινή επίσημη υποδοχή του. Ένα κορυφαίο επιστήμονα, σεμνό άνθρωπο, ευχάριστο, με αδαμάντινο ήθος και χαρακτήρα, ένα φιλέλληνα. Βιογραφικά στοιχεία και θέσεις. Ο καθηγητής Αλμπέρτο Καρπιντέρι γεννήθηκε στην Πολωνία της Ιταλίας το 1952. Είναι έγγαμος και πατέρας δύο τέκνων. Έλαβε το δίπλωμα του πολιτικού μηχανικού από το Πανεπιστήμιο της Μπολονίας. Είναι κάτοχος δύο διδακτορικών διπλωμάτων από το Πανεπιστήμιο της Μπολονίας στις περιοχές της πυρηνικής φυσικής και των μαθηματικών. Είναι καθηγητής δομικής μηχανικής του Τμήματος Πολιτικών Μηχανικών του Πολυτεχνείου του Τωρίνο από το 1986 έως σήμερα. Διετέλεσε διευθυντής του Τμήματος Δομικής Μηχανικής του Πολυτεχνείου αυτού, ιδρυτικό μέλος και διευθυντής του Μεταπτυχιακού Τμήματος Δομικής Μηχανικής, πρόεδρος της Διεθνούς Εταιρείας Μηχανικής της Θράψεως, της Ευρωπαϊκής Εταιρείας Δομικής Ακυρεότητος των Κατασκευών, της Διεθνούς Ενώσεως Μηχανικής της Θράψεως για Κατασκευές από Σκυρόδεμα του 2004-2007, πρόεδρος της Ιταλικής Εταιρείας Μηχανικής της Θράψεως από το 1998 έως το 2005, αντιπρόεδρος του Ερευνητικού Ινστιτούτου Μετεωρολογίας της Ιταλίας από το 2006 έως το 2009. Διετέλεσε μέλος του Διοικητικού Συμβουλίου της Εταιρείας Πειραματικής Μηχανικής των Ηνωμένων Πολιτειών και επισκέπτης καθηγητής στα Πανεπιστήμια Λίχαη των ΗΠΑ, Τσίγκουα και Τόντζι της Κίνας και στο Ινστιτούτο Τεχνολογίας της Μασαλίας. Διετέλεσε επιστημονικός εκδότης του περιοδικού Μεκάνικα, του εκδοτικού οίκου Σπρίνγκερ και μέλος της εκδοτικής επιτροπής σε 11 περιοδικά στην περιοχή της δομικής μηχανικής και των κατασκευών. Έδωσε πολλές διαλέξεις σε πανεπιστήμια και ερευνητικά Ινστιτούτα κατόπιν προσκλήσεως Δεν θα αναφέρω τις χώρες, αλλά γενικά καλύπτουν ίσως όλη την Ιφίλιο. Καθοδήγησε 30 μεταπτυχιακούς σπουδαστές, οι οποίες κατέχουν καθηγητικές θέσεις σε πανεπιστήμια εντός και εκτός της Ιταλίας. Έχει δημοσιεύσει περισσότερες από 1.000 ερευνητικές εργασίες. Ένας αριθμός πολύ μεγάλος για καθηγητές της μηχανικής. Εγώ δεν ξέρω άλλον ο οποίος έχει φτάσει σε αυτό το ύψος των επιστημονικών δημοσιεύσεων, εκ των οποίων οι 500 είναι σε επιστημονικά περιοδικά και οι άλλες είναι σε διεθνή συνέδρα. Έχει συγγράψει ο ίδιος 13 βιβλία στην Ιταλική και είναι εκδότης 25 βιβλίων. Επίσης, έχει συγγράψει 10 συγγράμματα ή στην Αγγλική, τα οποία έχουν δημοσιευθεί από διεθνείς επιστημονικούς οίκους. Περισσότερες από 14.000 αναφορές με δίκτυα επιχείσεως 64 κατά τη βάση δεδομένων Σκόπους, ενώ κατά τη βάση δεδομένων G-Scholar, δίκτυα πύχης 86 και περισσότερες από 30.000 αναφορές. Τιμητικές διακρίσεις. Είναι εταίρος της Ακαδημίας Επιστημών του Τωρίνου που ιδρύθηκε από το Λαγκράντζ το 1783. Εξελέγει το 2005. Του Ινστιτούτου Λομπάρντο της Ακαδημίας Επιθυμών και Γραμμάτων του Μιλάνου. Της Ακαδημίας Τετίνα Περσαϊένζε, της Ακαδημίας Σάντα Τεοντόρα, της Ακαδημίας Επιστημών της Μπολονίας, της Ευρωπαϊκής Ακαδημίας Επιστημών και Τεχνών, της Ευρωπαϊκής Ακαδημίας Επιστημών, της Ακαδημίας Ευρωπαία και της Διεθνούς Ακαδημίας Μηχανικών. Αυτή τη στιγμή είναι ο πρόεδρος της τάξης των μηχανικών της Ευρωπαϊκής Ακαδημίας Επιστημών. Είναι επίτιμος διδάκτορ της Ρωσικής Ακαδημίας Επιστημών και του Πανεπιστημίου Κωνσταντίνιαν της πολιτείας Rhode Island των Ηνωμένων Πολιτειών. Είναι κάτοχος του μεταλλείου Griffith της Ευρωπαϊκής Εταιρείας Δομικής Ακυαρεότητας των Κατασκευών, του μεταλλείου Hermit της RILEM, της τιμητικής διαλέξεως Swedlow της Αμερικανικής Εταιρείας Δομικής των Υλικών, του μεταλλείου της Ιαπωνικής Εταιρείας Μηχανικών, του βραβείου Frocht της Διεθνούς Εταιρείας Πειραματικής Μηχανικής, το χρυσό μετάλλιο του Paul Paris της Διεθνούς Εταιρείας Μηχανικής της Θράψεως, του μεταλλείου Giuliani Preparata της Διεθνούς Εταιρείας Condensed Matter Nuclear Science, εταίρος της Αμερικανικής Εταιρείας Πολιτικών Μηχανικών και της Ευρωπαϊκής Εταιρείας Δομικής Ακυαρότητας των Κατασκευών, της Διεθνούς Εταιρείας Μηχανικής της Θράψεως και της Διεθνούς Εταιρείας Θράψεως των Κατασκευών Σκιαροδέματος. Είναι επίτιμος καθηγητής στα πανεπιστήμια Tianjin και Founding της Κίνας και Founding Fellow της Ινδικής Εταιρείας Δομικής Ακυαρεότητος, καθηγητής στο Πανεπιστημίο Σαντού της επαρχίας Guangdong της Κίνας από το 1919. Κατά την τελευταία τριακονταετία συνεργάζεται στενά με καθηγητές και ερευνητές ελληνικών ΑΗ, έχει δώσει σειρά διαλέξεων, συμμετείχε σε πολλά συνέδρα και συμπόσια που έχουν οργανωθεί στην Ελλάδα. Όπως μάλιστα μου είπε σήμερα ο ίδιος, αυτή είναι η 10η επίσκεψή του στην Ελλάδα. Επίλογος. Αγαπητές συνάδελφε και φίλε Αλμπέρτο, η γνωριμία μας ανάγεται στο έτος 1982, όταν νεαροί επιστήμονες αναζητούσαμε νέους ορίζοντας στα ερευνητικά μας ενδιαφέροντα. Εγώ είχα ήδη περατώσει ένα χρόνο εκπαιδευτικής άδειας στο Πανεπιστήμιο Λίχαη, τον είπα, και εσύ ξεκινούσες την επίσκεψή σου. Και οι δυο μας συνεργαστήκαμε με έναν εξαιρετικό καθηγητή της μηχανικής, τον George C. Και οι δυο μας θεραπεύσαμε την ερευνητική αυτή περιοχή. Εσύ από το Τωρίνο, εγώ από την Ξάνθη. Οι συναντήσεις μας ήταν συχνές, σε συνέδρα, αμοιβαίες επισκέψεις σε πανεπιστήμια μας, διαλέξεις, εκδηλώσεις. Σε διαδέχτηκα στην Προεδρία της Ευρωπαϊκής Ενώσεως Μηχανικής της Θράψεως και οργάνωσα το 14ο Διεθνές Συνέδριο Μηχανικής στη Ρόδο, όπως εσύ διοργάνωσες το 11ο Συνέδριο στο Τωρίνο με μεγάλη επιτυχία. Οι δρόμοι μας υπήρξαν παράλληλοι. Και τώρα συναντώμεθα στην Ακαδημία Αθηνών, όπου έχω τη χαρά και την τιμή να παρουσιάσω στον περιορισμένο χρόνο που διαθέτω το μεγάλο έργο σου. Ένα έργο που θα παραμείνει ανεξίτηλα τυπωμένο στην ιστορία της μηχανικής, των αστοχιών, στη δομική μηχανική, στο σκιαρόδεμα, στην πυρηνική φυσική, στις καταστροφές. Η Ακαδημία Αθηνών, σε αναγνώριση της μεγάλης συμβολής σου στην επιστήμη, σε υποδέχεται απόψη στους κόλπους της, ευχόμενη όπως και από τη θέση αυτή του αντιπιστέλλοντος μέλους, θα συνεχίσεις με το ίδιο πάθος και αγάπη να θεραπεύεις την επιστήμη της μηχανικής που τόσο ηγάπη σας. Και, and a few words in English, my dear colleague and friend Alberto, according to the protocol of the Academy of Athens, I presented the salient points of your academic career with your outstanding contribution in science in Greek. I'm asking for your understanding. I would like to take this opportunity to welcome you to the Academy of Athens, the most prestigious academic institute in Greece. My warmest congratulations. Ευχαριστώ πολύ.
Ευχαριστώ και εγώ, κύριε Γκρούτο. Και τώρα θα καλέσω τον τιμόμενο να παραλάβει το δίπλωμα. Now I'd like to invite you, dear colleague, to receive the diploma as corresponding member of the Academy of Athens. This is your diploma. And this is also a small decoration as a symbol, of your membership in the Academy. This is a silver decoration. You can put it here on your jacket. Yeah. Okay. And now I invite you to take the floor and to address the audience. Δίνω το λόγο τώρα να τον χειροκροτήσουμε. From now on, you are a member of the, Academy of Athens. Yeah.
Please have the
You'll
floor.
Take the floor, yeah.
First of all, I would like to, say that it is really a pleasure and a great privilege to be a member of a so glorious academy, the Academy of Athens. And I deeply want to, thank deeply the president of the academy and my, friend, is a lifelong friend, I think, Professor Gdoutos, who in some way presented me, introduced me to the academy. So thank you very much again. Then I know that I have to, say something about my, career, my work, and I, in some way, I've chosen a very general topic. In some way, it's a specialistic, of course, but it was, we can say, the fil rouge of my research activity for many years, more than 40 years, at least. So, in some way, I always observed that complexity sciences have some topics inside that are very useful for fracture mechanics, which was my major for many years, has been for many years my major topic. So, I think that at least two open problems of fracture mechanics can be solved, or at least improved. The knowledge of this topic is really improved through application of catastrophe theory at first, and then also fractal geometry. So I will speak, I hope to explain the main things about these two applications of complexity to fracture, or fracture mechanics. So now I begin to, some way to show you my slide. The first half of my presentation is on structural brittle behavior, scale effects, and application of catastrophe theory. as I told you already. So this is the first two images or pictures that I show are very, very relevant for this topic, because we see extreme cases. The first is the very well-known case of Liberty ships that were produced during the Second World War. They broke in a very brittle way, surprisingly, because the steel in the laboratory was ductile. So there was not any physical similitude in that case. The opposite case, also not only very brittle, but also at very low stresses, very low external load. The opposite happens for glass filaments. Glass filaments, you see the picture in the at the bottom of the slide, you can see that you have very large, we can say, deformability or ductility also, and at the same time a very high strength, very high strength. So we see that in some way we have ductility for small bodies and brittleness for large bodies. And why? So fracture mechanics can give a very important answer to this paradox. Yes, we see that this paradox is present not only at the extremity of the length scales. We have this strange, in some way judged in this way many years ago, not now, but was judged a strange behavior, but it is also familiar in the laboratory. Everyone knows, who operates in the laboratories, that large structures are brittle, have a brittle behavior, and the crack grow is unstable. Whereas small specimens in the laboratory, tendentially, are very ductile, and the crack grow is ductile. So opposite, just changing, not the material, but changing the scale. So it was, in some way, a paradox or a mystery up to 40 years ago, I think. Then we can say that we have three definitions in this slide. We have the ductile behavior, which means that after a linear elastic behavior, you have a peak, and then plasticity or ductility. When ductility, maybe that in the second case, you see in the upper figure, there is a brittle behavior, which means that the softening slope is higher. And at the end, we can have even catastrophic behavior. It means that the softening slope becomes positive. This is very well described by catastrophe theory. It is strange. Catastrophe theory was applied to many, many fields, different fields. And I think that the material strength is the last one. It's strange because the word catastrophe can recall just materials and structures and so on. But and I was among those who have given contributions in the, especially in the 80s and 90s, about this important paradox, we can say. Then we can say that if you control the test through the graph is a stress versus deformation or versus the same strain. If you control the test through the deformation or the strain, you have a vertical drop, and it is what you define brittleness or brittle rupture, a vertical drop in the loading capacity. What is interesting is that the area, the hatchet area, the hatchet area you can see in the bottom figure is the energy which is emitted by the specimen under vibrational nature or even kinetic energy in some cases. So it's very scientifically correct to study these problems in this way. I would like to remind you that this kind of behavior, I mean this snapback or catastrophic behavior, is present also in another mechanical phenomenon, which is buckling. And von Karman in the 40s, as the first researchers, realized that in that case, you have when you have buckling of thin cylinders, of thin elastic cylinders, you can have this snapback or catastrophic behavior. So it's not the first time that in mechanics we find a catastrophe theory applications in some way. Then going back to our problem, we can see that on the left you see a sigma versus epsilon, which means stress versus strain response of the specimen. And it is changing after the peak, only after the peak, it is changing by changing the length of the specimen. So we begin to see what the size or scale effects means. How can you explain this transition? In some way, you cannot. We cannot affirm that it is a constitutive law. So it is not a material property because it is changing with the length of the specimen. So you can solve in some way this problem using the cohesive crack model or cohesive crack length, diagram. You see that the first diagram on the right, the first one, is a sigma versus epsilon diagram for the ascending part. For the descending part, to have a scale invariant response, you need to use a cohesive law, which means a sigma versus W curve. W is the opening of the crack. It's not a non-dimensional quantity like a strain or the deformation is, but is a length. The dimension is a length. This is a material property. Sigma versus W. It's very well known a model today, I have to say. And the area below the curve, it is linear in this case, but in general it could be also non-linear. And the area below the curve is the fracture energy of the material. So it's a very important property, fracture energy of the material. So under this hypothesis or assumptions, you can solve the problem and understand even the paradox that I presented before. So the solution, this is very, very, in some way, is the most simple you can invent, is they are three bars with three different lengths, and you see that the answer of the three bars is a triangle in some way. The first side is the increasing, the ascending part, and then you have the descending one. And you can observe that the area is always the same because it's GF. And really, I have to say that it is sigma versus delta, where delta is the displacement of the bottom part of the specimen. So you see that in some way we can say that the area is always the same for the three triangles because it's GF, the dissipated energy through fracture. Then we have that also sigma u, this is the ultimate strength, is the same, so the height of the triangle, and also wc is the same, where wc is the critical crack opening displacement, means that beyond which you have no interaction between the faces of the crack. So you have the base of the triangle, the height, and the area is the same, of course. So very elementary rules that in some way behind which you have a very important phenomenon, this transition that I'm going to describe. Okay, I think I can go on. Then when you have not only traction, but for example, bending or flexure of a specimen, you can describe in concrete the situation with a cohesive zone or a process zone. It is the intermediate one between the stress-free crack and the virgined part of the specimen. So you have non-linear phenomena like microcracking in the matrix, the bonding between matrix and aggregates, and lastly, we can say bridging between the two faces through the aggregates, maybe through fibers also, but in this case it's through. So this is a nonlinear, strongly nonlinear zone, which is described very synthetically by the cohesive crack model that I described also through the two, by the two, we can say, constitutive law that I described some minutes ago. And you see that the definition of sigma, they are the bridging forces, no? There is a distribution of bridging forces. Of course, I don't escape all the mathematics about that, but you can recognize sigma ultimate at the fictitious crack tip, you see, and WC, which is the critical crack opening displacement, at the real crack tip. So, very synthetically, of course. But this is very powerful model, because in this case, in this way, we can describe the paradox I explained before. In this case, we have this is a bending problem. I mean, a specimen with an initial crack, for example, a three-point bending. We call it three-point bending, for example, with a bending situation, a condition around the crack in the center. And we have a numerical algorithm that I've not the time to describe because it's very specialistic, but in this way we can describe very carefully the softening, but even the catastrophic branches of the curves. So you see, for example, when you have a concrete specimen, you consider the scaling of this specimen from 10 centimeters, the depth of the specimen, 20, you see the second on the right, then 40 and 80. You see there is a very clear transition from a normal softening, no? It means that the reaction of the specimen is decreasing, but not in a catastrophic way. But both bottom curves are both with the catastrophic branches, you see. It means that the scale or the size is very important, and we have a tendency to have brittle behavior with large specimens. Then in this slide, I prepare the speech for the next slide, because we have on the left, we have an integer specimen, means without initial crack, where there is an assessment according to the maximum stress, sigma max. And on the right, we have an initially cracked specimen, where the assessment is given by the comparison of K1, which is the stress intensity factor, with K1C, which is the fracture toughness. But I will say more in the next slides. Going back to our algorithm, you can see very interesting things in the diagram, non-dimensional load versus non-dimensional deflection or central deflection of the specimen. You see that there is a family of curves varying the brittleness number SE. This brittleness number is a mixture in some way of mechanical properties of the material and the size of the structures. You see, is defined in the upper part of the slide. It is GF, fracture energy, over strength of the materials, sigma U, times the H, which is the depth of the beam. So the size, it is important to have, because it is non-dimensional. The two material parameter have different physical dimensions. So you need to put also the size in the non-dimensional number. It is, in some way, very synthetic way to see the problem, because you see that the shape of the response is completely different. When SE is very small, you have even on the left, where you have no initial crack, you have a snapback or a catastrophe in the very brittle behavior. On the right, where you have a 0 over H, it means the initial depth of the crack, equal to 0.5, you have that, you have normal softening, you have not this. So this non-dimensional number, brittleness number, SE, is very important to describe the transition. Then we can say something about what happens by increasing the size. to two apparent material properties. The first is the apparent bending strength or tensile strength of the material. You see that by increasing the size, really we have a non-dimensional number, it is 1 over SE, the x-axis or horizontal axis. So in some way we are describing what happens by increasing the size, for example. And you see that the apparent strength of the material decreases from 3 times the true value to 1. It means to 1 or to sigma ultimate to the true value. I mean, see, it is asymptotic trend. It's very interesting because it means that only with very, very large specimens we can measure this property. Something similar happens for K1C. K1C is a material toughness. We have another asymptote, we can say, in the same way for very large sizes, we reach the true value of the parameter. So in other terms, this is the main conclusion of my papers in the 90s. Many years ago, I can say, but I clarified that in some way, if you look at the bottom diagram, when you have a very sharp snapback, you are describing very precise way, these classical conditions. The first sigma max equals sigma ultimate is the normal assessment according to the admissible stress, we can say. The second is K1 equal to K1C. So we discover that inside the nonlinear model, the cohesive crack model, we have the possibility to describe even the linear elastic fracture mechanics condition, which was not very clear at the time, I think. So this is, I think, the most important thing that my contribution can represent. Then the second part of the speech is about another problem in some way. Is a problem of material properties, scale effects of material properties, and synthetic description through the fractal geometry. I say some words about fractals or fractal sets. I give some example for whom is not aware of them or has not a specific preparation. Of course, we can say that we have some archetypes of lacunar fractals. For example, this is very well known in any book. There is at first this set is the Cantor set or Cantor dust. You see that it's obtained by a sequence of deletion operations. And it's a very rarefied because it's a limit. When you go to K is going to infinite, you cannot see it in some way. But the dimension is not going to zero. Dimension is about 0.63. So it's very abstract model. But we will see that can describe a reality. Then we have the Weierstrass-Deville staircase function, which is in some way is defined over, you see, the domain of the function over the Cantor set. Then we have variation according to randomness. It is a random Cantor set. I don't want to insist too much. But and then we have in 2 dimensions, very important, this Sierpinski gas or carpet, Sierpinski carpet, which also is obtained by a sequence of deletion operations. You can imagine you extract every time 1 square, which is about, not about, is exactly 1/9 of the black area. In this way, is a very graphical idea, but there is a mathematics also, of course, behind. You have a dimension that is not 2, is not 0, but is 1.89, very, very precisely. And then is a very interesting example given by Mandelbrot himself. This is a random fractal, we can say lacunar fractal, of dimension 1.9. Mandelbrot used computer graphics. So we can say that you see the use of this concept in the case of attraction specimen, no? Like similar to that I introduced previously. In this case, you see on the left the definition of the, you can say, the cross-section at the peak load. You can think that also in this case, the Mandelbrot set is the cross-section at the peak load. So something that which it is in some way is not an area, is something less. No? In fact, we see that I put this dimension d equal to 2 minus something. This something is d sub sigma, I call it in this way. The second concept is related to the distribution of fracture or transverse cracks or fracture. You see that you can assume a Cantor distribution. So in this case, the dimension is 1 minus d epsilon. In this case, you can imagine 0.63 in my example. It was a deterministic fractal, but we can think also in a random way. And then what is most interestingly, in my opinion, is that the product of these two lacunar fractal becomes the damage domain, which is a product, in some way, a Cartesian product. And there is a theorem, no? I had the it was so lucky that I could find a theorem saying that this is a Cartesian product, so this product is 3 minus the 2d, d sigma and d epsilon. It is equal to 2 plus something, because it's invasive. In this case, it's invasive fractal. So I used in this way this concept according to the elementary concepts of solid mechanics. Then, by simple mathematics, because mathematics is quite simple, what is difficult is the concept of fractality, and using the renormalization group condition, which you can read in the top part of the top of the slide, we can obtain the three fundamental power laws governing stress or strength also, critical strain, and lastly, we can say fracture energy. The difference is that you have lacunar fractal and then negative exponents for the first two. And we have invasive fractal and then a positive exponent for the last fracture energy. So, of course, it's not easy, but nowadays I think it's quite clear, even because in the 90s we obtained very important experimental results in Torino and in Delft. In Torino in 94, in Delft we will see afterwards, it will be very, very short. But you can think that the two power laws reported in B-logarithmic diagrams, you see, for GF is increasing with slope 0.38, for sigma ultimate is decreasing with slope 0.14. So we have these two slopes. They are always between 0 and 1/2, experimentally, but also theoretically. Why? But we can be ahead. I didn't see it, didn't say it, because we have this, the bottom formula, I didn't comment, is the sum of d sigma, d epsilon, and dg is equal to 1. So it means that the disorder is, in any case, is limited. It's very important. And according to this, we can also argument about the slope of this. Excuse me, I skipped this. Anyway, we have to, in some way, experimental confirmation of the power law. And then what is important is that you can describe things. You see there is a sequence of diagrams. The first is a sigma versus epsilon, the right diagram on the top right is sigma versus epsilon. Is not a constitutive law, because it's completely different by changing the size of the specimen. Then you have sigma versus W, which is the cohesive law, normal cohesive law, and the last is the fractal cohesive law, where we have completely different and anomalous dimensions. You see, for example, the vertical axis of the last diagram is Newton, over millimeter, not rise to 2, as is normal for a stress, but rise to 1.86. And then the other axis is millimeter, not over millimeter as a non-dimensional strain, but over millimeter rise to 52. So in this way, we renormalize both axes, and we have the real constitutive law, which has a very particular, strange physical dimensions. This was seen with our specimens. I've shown here our specimen. You see, the biggest was high, 1 meter and 60 centimeters. Then in Holland, it was very interesting because they used five different scales. The largest panel was 2.4 meters high. 2.4, so very big specimens, and five different, not three, but five. And we can see that there was a very good alignment of the points in the bilogarithmic diagrams, and the reasoning is the same that I have already presented. What is very interesting that also in this case, the third choice means not sigma epsilon, not sigma versus W, but this sigma star versus epsilon star with anomalous dimensions can satisfy or reproduce very, very well the five experimental curves. So you understand that we can conclude that in this way that the constitutive law does exist, but not in the entire dimensions. You have to abandon the entire dimension. It's very, of course, for engineers, is very, very, uncomfortable. But we can say that is the only way to obtain this invariant response of the material. And I think it's a very old problem, but in this way, I think maybe. Solved at any scale. Of course, for concrete is very evident. With other material, maybe you have to use smaller scales. There is some specification if you want, but I can conclude saying that in the 2020 I published a book on, I was very happy to succeed in this very difficult adventure to publish a book on all these topics. Thank you very much for your attention.
Κύριε συνάδελφε, καθηγητά Καρπεντιέρη, σας ευχαριστούμε για την πολύ ενδιαφέρουσα ομιλία σας. Η Ακαδημία Αθηνών σας καλωσορίζει με ιδιαίτερη τιμή και σας απευθύνει θερμές ευχές για την επιτυχή συνέχιση του έργου σας. Dear colleague, Professor Carpentieri, we'd like to congratulate you on your very interesting speech. The Academy of Athens welcomes you and wishes you every success in your future research work. This session is over. Λύεται η συνεδρίαση.